Okay.
Hi, Tom.
Now I'm home. Now I'm home. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Fantastic.
Hey, it's like basically you have to wait a decade between seeing Tom Bezuchas or not.
Well, you and me both.
I have a child who's as old as your last movie.
I know. Isn't that crazy?
Is everything burning? Is the burning stopped?
Oh, I know. It's crazy. I know.
It's, you know, the Trump administration has to say everything's burning at all times. Otherwise, and New York is over. New York is done. Former New York.
No way.
Not at all. Never. Not a chance in the world.
No, it's great.
They could lock the doors. Everybody could be stuck inside forever, and it would still somehow be New York.
I know.
The ants would crawl out of the windows and
I know.
Reopen Broadway or something.
I know. It can't happen soon enough.
So,
yes.
We actually ever done one of these?
No.
I don't think we ever did a video after all those
years. No, we didn't. No.
Kind of crazy.
Yeah.
Well, the basic idea is to chat. Feel free to wander. Feel free to curse. Yeah. We run it uncut. I know you don't do a lot of cursing, but
okay.
It runs uncut like a conversation more than a...
Oh, now I'm in trouble. All right.
Because you're not a good conversationalist, is that?
And I like to cuss.
Well, you can cuss away.
Okay, good.
Cuss till the end of the time. It's funny that I didn't even realize this was your movie until Mike Giacchino put up a tweet saying I did this Western music for a movie and I can't believe it. And then I looked it up for a second. I realized it was you, and I was like, "Who thought Tom Bezucha would be doing a Western?"
Tom Bezucha did.
Did you? What was that? Was it just? How did it start? Was it a book?
No, I found the book. I've been a fan of Larry Watson, the author of Let Him Go. He wrote a book called Montana 1948. Couple decades ago that I had read and really loved, and I have just followed him ever since, and read this one and thought I have an idea how to do this, and was sort of lucky enough to end up, I talked to Larry, and I took a couple liberties with the book that I wanted him to be cool with, and He was great, and I fell in love with the characters.
Were you just waiting for the right book to kind of land up on your desktop and?
Sort of like I've been doing these adaptations lately, and I've enjoyed them. The Guernsey literary thing, and Leary's novel, The Good House, which comes out next year, and I've always been a reader. And some of them just hook you, and you sort of think, "Oh, I think I know how to do this one." And and then they don't, and then you can't forget about them, and that's a good sign.
So, in this case, character first, or very unusual story structure first?
It is. It was definitely it's of course, it's always the characters first for me. And what was great was it had this thriller engine in shape. But then it was the opportunity to paint, this intimate portrait of a long marriage with the Margaret and George characters.
And so did it come together quickly? Is this an easy pitch?
This one, it wasn't a pitch. It wasn't really a pitch because I knew that wouldn't. Who's going to buy? The pitch. I had worked with Paula Mazur on the Guernsey project, and we had a great time. Great time, and they were, she and Mitchell Kaplan and Kimmy Armstrong Stein, her partners, were saying, what do you want? Anything you want to do? What do you want to do? And I said, there's a book, and I love this book. I'll do it. I'll adapt it on spec. But here's the deal. This is how it ends. And that's given, and it's period. And we're never going to have that conversation again. And they were fine, because some other people I talked to about it were not fine with those elements.
And so the period was part of what you loved about it.
For sure. Definitely. I mean, because it's also you don't want the internet, you don't want cell phones, you don't want all those things that wreck a narrative. And it also it's a Western, but it's a Western only in as much as that's sort of our American mythology. I liked that it felt like a fable. And I, you know, often sort of talked to, the idea I had was that what you're seeing is sort of the grandson telling you the story of how his grandparents saved him, in a way, that it had this nostalgia thing baked right into it.
Well, it definitely has it in looking at Kevin in it was, it made me think of A Perfect World. And that it was a sequel for him.
Huge, for sure. Yeah.
And then, of course, Michael's score is very much out of the Clint Eastwood oeuvre. If Clint Eastwood had more musical talent,
he's pretty talented. But both those people.
But all he really does
is the thing. Yeah, no, Michael, you know, this is my third time working with Michael, who can do. Obviously can do anything, but the, you know, when we were, it was a really hard movie to temp score, and you know, it's funny, the Clint Eastwood thing, it definitely, there's a spareness around the score to Unforgiven that was not unhelpful.
So the process of putting it together, you made this commitment to what it was going to be.
Yeah.
Did you start looking for talent before you went for financing, or did you?
We'll finance it if you get this person or that person. It's always the way it works. But I won the lottery twice on this one. It's, you know, Diane, I'd written the script and was lucky enough to meet with Diane, and we had a lunch, and she had a real fix on what was interesting to her. And so she came on board, and then, you know, we went to Kevin and he responded. And I mean, it was in the scheme of things, this was all very, very fast.
Was Kevin obvious, or was it that a Diane idea, or?
No, Kevin was obvious. You know what? It's funny, I'm a fan of both of them, but when I was on my way to have lunch with her, I do what everybody does, and I went on YouTube and just looked at some stuff, and a junket piece came up for her and Kevin for Superman. And so, like, I'm not the bright person who came up with the idea, you know, it's like somebody was, but it's like, but I'm smart enough to recognize ketchup and mustard when I see them sitting on a table together. Like, those two things go together. And there was everybody can go do a little dive into it. But in one of the interviews, there was just this sweet sort of dance that they were doing together in the interview that just felt like, I just want more of all of that, for sure.
So is that how you direct them? Do you just say, give me you guys?
they've been around the track a couple of times. They're just smart enough to give me you guys. But we also had, you know, they both, thankfully, they love to rehearse as much as I do. And so we got a week together before we started shooting. And it was just, you know, it was just their intimacy, which was really fun to go through those scenes and figure out, you know, who's in the power seat in this moment, and then how it all shifts around.
Well, he's pretty quiet in the first half of the movie.
Yeah, he is, isn't he? He's pretty quiet. Yeah.
It's a pretty quiet performance for him. Yeah. So he does those. I mean, it's interesting. Kevin is one of those guys who kind of fits the bill for the you know, superstar look at me thing. And at the same time also is willing to go these places.
No. And also, like, you look at his work and, or the, how many, I don't think it's an obvious thing about him. But you feel it about him as a man, his support of strong women. Like, he's not afraid of a strong lady. And I really respect that about him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's, yeah.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So you have, were you ever concerned about the structure? I mean, it is such a, I think it's one of the, you know, when you see the marketing for it, it's, I think, one of the things that's still stumping focus a little bit, which is trying to balance what the movie is, because it's distinctly separate pieces or moments, yeah. or the energy, it makes sense, but it's like, it's such a change of energy.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. It's sort of like when you find out the mother has cancer in the family stone. It's right. in your Christmas comedy. I liked, you know, I don't know. It's sort of what I liked about the piece was, you know, I like an uncomfortable dinner table scene as a pivot point in the middle of a movie. Right. And that's,
well, you certainly have one here.
that's my jam.
Is it scary to go into a scene like, I mean, that kind of scene was, it's very easy to go over the top, which you managed not to do, but it's a high wire act, I would say.
It's a high wire, but that's the fun of it. But it's also, you know, I think, you know, you also have the safety of like these incredibly accomplished performers, but in Leslie's so great. And I don't know. It's sort of the more I think about Blanche, the Leslie character now, she in some ways sounds awful, but kind of reminds me of my dad's mother, in that she had her hair done and wore a dress like that and enjoyed performing. And that was sort of a key to understanding, for me, to understanding Blanche, was she is a little over the top, but that's who she is as a person too, that she is a performer and she's performing for them in that scene. Like the whole thing is staged. She's figured it out. And it's a staged warning. And it was fun to do with Leslie.
Well, kind of turns from a perfect world into Animal Kingdom in a quick moment.
Right. Right. Right.
Leslie is not the traditional character person you would expect to be in that role, unlike Kevin and Diane.
Right. Well, I definitely, you know, what I didn't want was I didn't want them to come into the house and it's like Ma Barker with a, you know, a beret and a cigar and a.
You want Shelley Winters?
Right. I wasn't interested in that. I think it's better if you don't. She's so unpredictable. That character, and starting with how she looks.
Was that part of the book or was that something you guys figured out?
No, she's really different in the, I think in the book, she has black straight hair and she also goes running out of the house to greet them in the book. And I knew I didn't want that. She's the spider in the nest, just waiting for them to come in and then reveals herself. The hair was Blanche's idea, or was Leslie's idea. But in the book, she is described, she is wearing, this was the thing that stuck with me, was she's described as having a fuss of makeup. And so that was sort of the starting point.
And Leslie herself, what was the process that she ended up with you in this thing? Because she's obviously doing some American films, but not a lot. She's, you know.
Which is just crazy because she can do them. She can do anything. I mean, she's so great.
She's too good for them in some ways. Not her personally, not her ego, but her.
I think
we're scared to take it on.
How many roles are there for? How many roles are there worthy? Roles for women of 64 worthy of somebody of her caliber.
Never occurred to me that she was 64 until just now.
Yeah.
You've ruined her, Tom.
She's great. Great.
She's 34. I still think of her as a young sprout.
She's 34.
Uh-huh. Well, it's amazing. We went through the entire award season, I guess, 2 years ago. It seems like a lifetime ago. And seven people ever realized that she was married to Gary Oldman in the past. It was like,
Yeah.
It was like a non-conversation of all the many obvious conversations of that season.
Yeah.
That one never became a conversation.
Yeah.
I guess it's hard to imagine now.
It was long ago.
It was long ago. They were kids. They really were 24.
No, I think that's right. I think that's right. Yeah.
It was the first one for him.
Yeah. Yeah.
And his row of wives. Mm-hmm. He's had so many. So does doing this energy and this outdoors thing and the Western thing and the guns and all of that just come naturally? Do you have to figure this out as a director, how all this works, and study Western films? And
well, yeah, but then I mean, yeah, you look at the scenes and you think, oh, well, this will be a good point of reference.
Specific dance. It does not seem like you kind of like threw it on the stage and just ran. It's
No. It was definitely planned out, there's a, not to give too much away, but a specific injury in for Kevin in a motel room, and figuring out how I'm not so interested in geysers of blood and sort of the pornography of it, but more the consequence of the infliction of the violence. And so it was definitely a strategy how to approach the violence, and not to glorify it, but I think Kimberly Pierce did such a great job with Boys Don't Cry, and I definitely it was something I thought of a little bit, and Misery.
Mm-hmm.
The James Caan.
The hobbling.
Yeah.
Of James Caan. Exactly. Well, but I think throughout the whole thing, once they're together, the families have met each other,
mm-hmm.
There's definitely that, even as they come to the dinner, there's that sense they don't really want to sit down.
Right.
Like, Kevin's like, his back is against the wall almost the entire time. Like he's trying to wait for where his exit is, figure out his way out.
Right, right.
Before this even starts.
Yeah, where when they go to dinner. Yeah, no. Well, there was definitely. I mean, I think he and I both had the same idea that he, as a retired lawman, you go into a room, you're looking for points of egress, you're looking where people are standing, how you get out of that room, and he's got a whiff of something not good.
And is the road trip part of it fun for you to take them across the trip, or is that just kind of, we got to go from location to location, this is painful, let's get through
it? It's all fun and it's all pain, some of that stuff in the car was a lot of fun though, because it was, we did a really stripped down, like I wanted everything as practical as we could possibly make it, that it felt like a handmade movie, and that was critical to me, that I wanted, there's this sort of this modest integrity to the Margaret and George characters, that I wanted the whole thing to be a part of it, and so practical effects and all that sort of stuff. But shooting in that car, I mean, a lot of it was just Guy Godfrey, the DP, who I love him. It was just he and I in the trunk with Craig, the focus puller, over Kevin and Diane's shoulders. And those were some of the best times we had.
And they actually do touch Native American in this movie.
What do you mean?
well, they meet the boy.
They do touch one.
As they go, and they do touch one. But it's a very, he's kind of like the mystery sauce in this whole thing to me in some ways.
Well, go on.
Well, just it seems like he is, he has a purpose, but he doesn't have an incredibly specific purpose.
Right.
He seems almost more a spiritual addition to it and a reflection.
Right.
Their feelings than he does like a, you know, straight plain character.
He's in the book and he's a little, you know, I kept thinking like, okay, it's, you know, you don't want him to be the magical person of color that comes and assists the nice white couple. But, I tried it without him, and for me, what he always represented was, you know, I came up with this backstory about him having been taken from his family and to the Indian schools. And so it was, you know, it's like what could happen to their grandson. He's living in a limbo now. He doesn't belong in any one world. And I also felt like he was the ghost of their son. That was really sort of, that he is a phantom character for sure. He's a lost boy. And that was, I think that that's probably why he stayed more than anything. He is Native American, but more than that, he is the soul of a lost boy that they encounter in this landscape. And I think that's why he stayed.
Well, he does seem like what could be, or what one would imagine could be, but not just for their son. It was almost like for everybody,
right?
She's out there riding the horse on the, you know, in his horse, kind
yeah.
of.
Yeah.
He reflects a lot of things. And then when he does get involved functionally,
yeah.
It's certainly not as a magical American, a Native American.
No.
And is so reluctant along the way as well.
Sure. Yeah.
But I guess that reflects the reluctance that everybody has in the, you know, ultimately almost everybody in the movie is reluctant on some weird level.
Except I am.
Except for Diane. But I think she, in a weird way, I think she's reluctant too. I think she's holding on to something. I mean, it's not a natural choice for her to hold on the way she holds on.
No, she's grieving.
Yeah. But I mean, I think that's the, in many ways, that's the payoff of at least that part of the movie, is that, you know, the inevitability of something destructive happening to somebody who's trying that hard to keep in control.
Right.
I mean, it's always a balance like between her and between them, because they're also have that. I mean, all three of them really dance that dance of what is good control, sure. What is bad control.
Yeah. Well, I always sort of thought that Margaret and Blanche are two sides of one coin. It's just, you know, one has a dark face and one has a light face, and that they're both determined to do the same thing, which is to keep their family together.
Right.
And, you know, one's insane and one is less insane.
So it's then Kevin and the boys are reflective of one another in a similar way?
No, they're just that it's a ladies' fight.
Yes, but
it's between the mothers. It's between the mothers, for sure.
So it's like Alien 2 is what we're saying.
Something like that. Oh, yeah. No, it's, yeah. It's,
another right. reflection that you didn't expect to have coming
No, up. Diane is Ripley. And, right. yeah.
And mm-hmm. I guess there's no little blonde girl, but outside of that.
No, it's the grandson.
Little blonde boy. Yeah.
Yeah. The grandson. Jimmy. It's Jimmy.
So, okay, so you obviously wrote it, you got the money for it, you got this amazing cast for it. Is it an easy shoot? Is it a hard shoot? Is it just a shoot or are they always hard and that's what it is? Or
no, it was, in the scheme of things, you know, it's one of those, like, it's also like once they're over and a year has passed, it's like, was it that bad? It was pretty, it was harrowing in terms of worrying about the weather, because we were under or over schedule. We didn't have enough time. And so that locked us into, we were at the mercy of weather. We got lucky, but it wasn't cool having to check the weather every 5 minutes. But we also, the other thing is we had an incredibly, because of Kevin's schedule, we had to get him done for Yellowstone. We had the most accelerated pre-production I've ever had. And that was the hardest. I think that was the hardest part. It was the shooting schedule and the accelerated pre-production. But the shoot itself was, you know, I like shooting. It was joyful. I love actors. It's fun.
And post, was that, did everything just slot right into place when you got to post?
Yeah. I worked for a time with Meg Redeker here in New York, editing, and Jeff Ford, who I did Family Stone and Monte Carlo with, was finishing Avengers. And then I came out to LA and finished with him and worked with Michael again. And it's just, you know, it's all home week. It's just great.
And is it fun releasing a movie in a pandemic?
You know, less fun than not. It's nice to let the horse out of the barn, but you know, you wish, I wish I could be with you. I wish, yeah, I could, you know, see it with, go into a packed theater. It would be great.
And is this our pace from now? You've now gone from 4 years to 5 years to, say, 10 years.
Come on. No, I hope not.
You're not going fast. Well, does it matter whether you make another 7 films or do you just waiting for the right thing?
I'd like to get me a great book, get me a great script. I'll go in the spring. I'm happy.
So you'll have that moment of just, okay, this is what it is, and I'm going to go forward at some point.
What do you mean?
When the right material comes to you or the right idea comes to you or.
Yeah, no, it's just, you have to fall in love.
And until then, you just kind of treading water and making TV or whatever?
Well, you're working.
I just, like, I'm concerned about your output. I mean,
I appreciate that.
You only have another 40, 50 years of filmmaking.
We'll both make a concerted effort to improve.
Well, you know, it's funny because sometimes people take a long time between films and then they're like, okay, I'm going to make the next one in the next year because I've had it with waiting.
Yeah, yeah.
You're kind of at peace with this, the way it comes out naturally.
You know, I'll say this. I'd like to make them more often, but it doesn't always happen. Mm. Yeah.
It's fate.
You know,
that's been your life. It's life of the unexpected.
Exactly. So. But yeah.
Well, it's lovely seeing you.
You too.
I feel the hook pulling from the publicists, but
okay,
as they should be. That's their job, but you know, yeah, nonetheless.
I know, but I'm so happy to see you.
We could just sit here and have lunch. It would be nice to chat with you. But it is lovely seeing you, and congratulations on the movie. And I hope it gets the right amount of attention given the circumstances. It's hard out there.
Well, you feel like people are at home, and we might have some eyeballs.
That's true. That's right. True. No, people definitely are going to want to see them together, yeah, and then you're keeping the surprise very well. The surprises.
Great.
Nicely. So it'll be good. A lot of word of mouth.
Okay.
Good seeing you.
You too. Bye.